Thanks, Pat. My name is Frank Landis. I'm the co-chair of trustees here in Iowa United Methodist Church. Welcome, everyone. Friends new and old. Great. I'm kind of a filling-in for somebody, but so bear with me here. I guess this is a point where 2 years ago I would have been welcoming you to stay afterwards for refreshments, but we're not doing that. And I also have to welcome you not to sing the songs, because we don't sing out loud, we can hum if we want. So, anyway, the call for worship is in your bulletin and should be up there pretty soon. I'm not the only one who's filling in for somebody. There's a call for worship. Great. So please join me in your part there. Gracious God, your faithfulness startles us.
Your unconditional love encourages us.
We complain, wander, and stumble.
You love us.
We are tired, distracted, and afraid.
You love us.
We wonder how this could be possible, yet, through it all,
you love us.
Help us become as loyal to you as you are to us. Amen. Please join me in the unison opening prayer. Loving God, through Jesus, you have taught us to love one another, to love our neighbors as ourselves, and even to love our enemies. Help us to see each person in light of the love and grace you have shown us. Establish among us a future where peace reigns, justice is done with mercy, and all are reconciled. We ask these things in the name and for the sake of Jesus. Amen. Now please listen to him and feel free to come along.
Good morning. It's children's time today. I'm actually going to do a little bit of the message that I'm coming later. This is called Two Wolves. A Cherokee elder was teaching his young grandson about life. A fight is going on inside him, said the boy. It is a terrible fight, and it is between two wolves. One is evil. He is anger, envy, sorrow, regret, greed, arrogance, self-pity, guilt, resentment, inferiority, lies, false pride, superiority, self-doubt, and ego. The other is good. He is joy, peace, love, hope, serenity, humility, kindness, benevolence, empathy, generosity, truth, compassion, and faith. This same fight is going on inside you and inside every other person too. The boy thought about it for a minute, and then he asked his grandfather, "Which wolf will win?" The elder simply replied, "The one you feed." But today's message is for us to try to feed the good one. Ladies and gentlemen, in today's performance, the role of Emily will be played by Emily Anderson. We're all kind of villains today, so please bear with us. The scripture reading is from the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 1 to 14, and 38 to 48. I'm actually reading from the New Revised Standard Version, not the NIV, so the different version of it. We start with the Beatitudes. When Jesus saw the crowd, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted you, the prophets were before you." And 38-48, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evildoer. But if anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go also the 2nd mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. You have heard it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. For what? For if you love only those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you are to greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. So I wanted to talk a little bit more about two rules. We're back, Amy. Isn't it nice to be back in the building, in the church, see our community? I remember 16, 17 months ago getting out of church where everything was just sort of starting. And I was out in the parking lot, I was shoulder hugging the youth, fist bumping. I made a joke about how, hey, this isn't so bad because we can't shake hands, but you know, the shoulder hugs are okay, and I'm a hugger, so right, everything's okay. And then within a week, we realized that wasn't the case, and everything changed. It was a long 14, 15 months. The last month, things finally started to open up. People were being vaccinated, were getting out there. It became great, right? Well, we do have to sign waivers. We have to make adjustments. We've got to steal. Do the lightning. We've got the Delta variant, ready to throw them all back into the abyss. But hey, it's summer, we can go out with our friends, we can get together, we can go eat. When I look at the news, the Western United States is on fire. Heck, even the Gulf of Mexico was on fire last month. Hurricane season started earlier than it ever has. We really have a climate crisis upon us. But we're here with our beautiful community, together, worshiping God. Our community together makes an outsized contribution to our community and to our bigger mission. The support we feel in this building is beautiful. And hey, Pastor Emily and her family can actually go on vacation. But then again, you have to put up with me. So overall, things are good, right? But not perfect. You see, everything comes with good and bad. Hopefully, for good and bad, but our world has hope. Hold that thought. Our Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So you might have noticed we may not be a well-oiled machine, or maybe we are a well-oiled machine. You know, it has to stand through my oil. Okay? Let me tell you a little bit about today's message. I'm excited to get a chance to speak with you. You know, probably almost 2 years. I decided to do something unprecedented. I was going to speak to the lectionary test. I've never done that. And then, inspiration hit. I saw the two wolves on the internet. And our own hand and our heart mentioned to me, wow, that's preachable. Another veteran, Mr. Cody, actually had preached on it. We had a little conversation on Twitter. And kind of like the sorting hat in Harry Potter, the two wolves picked me. So much for the lectionary. So Pam, being helpful, sent me a scripture that looked really well in the two wolves. Not the one we read. If you want to hear that scripture, come back next week. Bill Moore will warn you when you use that next week. So I picked out today's scripture. Unfortunately, the lectionary was John. And I gave the chapter and verses to Emily, but not the gospel. Bless her heart, everyone must have thought, wow, this is a really interesting scripture for that two wolves. Fortunately, in the last review of the wolves, I noticed my mistake. And we got it. So, it's been a, you know, unique start, but hopefully it will be meaningful, all the same. Let me read it again, real quick. Two Wolves, a Cherokee elder was teaching his young grandson about life. There is a fight going on inside me, he said. It's a terrible fight, and it's between two wolves. One is evil. He is anger, envy, sorrow, regret, grief, arrogance, self-pity, guilt, resentment, inferiority, lies, false pride, superiority, self-doubt, and ego. The other is good. He is joy, peace, love, hope, serenity, humility, kindness, benevolence, empathy, generosity, truth, compassion, and faith. The same fight is going on inside you, and it's like every other person do. The boy thought about it for a minute and asked his grandfather, which wolf will win? The elder simply replied, hold on, you feet. Well, this is true, and I got to thinking about these feelings in my life. And I kind of could imagine the next question from the grandson being, how do I be the good one? Right? And generally, as empathetic humans, we do feed the good one, right? And it feels good, right? It feels good to feed the good one. But in our everyday life, as last week Emily talked about, you know, we get busy, things get overwhelming, we have so much going on, and there's bad in this world. We get overwhelmed, and we don't always step back. And the question is, how do we actively look at our lives and determine which wolf will be there? I think all we can kind of do at times is look at our intentions, right? Our intentions will tell us which wolf will be there. Are we doing it out of love and passion? Or are we doing it out of greed or ego or resentment? You know, it is tricky, right? Because there are many things that I'm sure we're all in this case, we do things, we say things, we feel things that our intentions are good. And yet other people we love and respect do the opposite out of good intentions as well. So it's, you know, it's a little bit tricky. And so how are we called to really step back? Right? I believe we're called to prayerfully meditate on the aspects of our life. This is exactly what Emily was talking about last week. Right? God will help us be the right wolf if we only let him. But how do we let him? I'm going to go back to what Emily said last week because it fits perfectly. Right? Realize Jesus is the cornerstone. Right? We're called to center on Jesus. Follow where God is leading. So we're called, you know, especially in these overwhelming situations, we're called to spend time in prayer with God. Slow down. Spend some time. Surround yourself with people who care for you and love you, like we have here. Seek unity in the community. Embrace our diversity. Reconcile with our differences. Be cognizant of that which brings us together more than what tears us apart. Remember, we're called to love and to social justice. Think back to when I was in high school, you know, and that was the start of people wearing the bracelets, WWJD, what would Jesus do? You know, it's still around today, and I just love that, right? Because literally, we ask, what would Jesus do? Jesus always falls on the side of compassion and inclusion. Right? Always. I think about today's scripture. Well, if you're in the Beatitudes, it's not the blessed are the successful, the rich, the powerful. Right? It's those in need. It's those who need, those who help those in need. It's those who are poor in spirit, those who mourn, the meek. Those who thirst for righteousness, the merciful, the peacemakers, those who are persecuted for goodness. We also heard that we're called to turn the other cheek, give up our cloak as well, to go the extra mile. We're called not to love our neighbors and hate our enemies. We're called to realize that everyone is our neighbor. We're called, quite simply, to love. This allows me to recite my favorite scripture. You guys learned it every time I preach. Matthew 22, 37 through 40. And he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." That really, that last one is mine. He's going to get to it, right? I mean, if we really love our neighbor, we wouldn't need laws and rules, right? We would do the right thing, we would learn to, and we wouldn't know how to do it. John Wesley tends to, I'll talk about him a little bit, but he tends to almost make those two commandments one commandment, right? Because to truly love God, we are in social justice. And that's an important thing, because how do you love those people you will never even meet? Right? That's what we're called for, but we don't need them. How do we love those people that we may not even meet? I think the way is to live in social justice. I'm so proud to be a Methodist, not only because of the way our church locally practices social justice, but that is a foundational part of who we are. Right? John Wesley said, "The gospel of Christ knows no religion but social, no holiness but social holiness. Faith working by love is the length and breadth and depth and height of Christian perfection." Right? So that's sort of that pulling that together. And of course, you know, this famous saying, do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. Right? This is how we love our neighbors, that we want them to ever leave. So if we get back to the wolves, right? This is how we feed the good wolf, right? And if we're looking at are we doing is feeding the good wolf, then you know that's good sounding wolf. Right? And the great thing about wolves too is that they don't feed alone. Right? They feed the pack. They care for the community. Right? They go out hunting and they're pups. A couple of wolves stay back with the pups to protect them. Right? And they still eat. They feed the community. Our metaphysical wolves do the same. And you don't feed our wolves in a vacuum. When we feed our wolves, it grows and affects the community. This is both scary and comforting. Right? Because, you know, with what we're feeding, that's what we're feeding our community. It's kind of like, I think about you know, the topical point right now, right, is vaccines, you know, they're just big, right? And you keep hearing it's not for you, right? Yeah, I want to protect myself, but it's protecting those you don't even know, that you might be in the community and not even just walk by, right? I mean, that's a beautiful example, right, of feeding the community by your own actions. So I mentioned good and bad earlier, right? So this is where it gets a little bit, you know, life can get overwhelming, right? I mean, we're in a climate crisis. We're in the political crisis. We're just hopefully coming out of an economic crisis. We're in the middle of a public health crisis that might be ramping up again. Right? How do you deal with that, and how do you feed your good wolf in a way that actually becomes matter? Again, I go back to what he always said, slow down. Center on Jesus. Spend time with God. Step back and just feed your own good wolf. Right? When all of us do that good wolf together, it feeds our community. And in our bigger community, in our larger community. It's like, you know, the waves of a pond. It will expand, it will eventually they extend across the whole entire direction of the planet. This is what I call the social justice version of think globally, act locally. When we feed our liberals, we can do way more than we ever could imagine. Again, I take a look at this little church. Our impact on the community is so much greater than 100 people would be expected to have. Right? This is beautiful, and we also, support the greater mission. Right? So, we are standing out. I mean, we help our community with standing out. When there's a hurricane, right? Humble Corps will be there. They'll be one of the first groups there. They'll be one of the last groups still there. Right? It's making we're standing out with it. I used to never really buy into that when I thought that it was sort of a humanistic standpoint. Act locally, I thought, well, that's just the way to feel good about doing small things and big things in the world. But then, that's what I wasn't thinking about, 20 volts, or 200 volts, or 2 million volts, right, or 2 billion volts around the world. Right? If you feed the liberal, it compounds. And together, all these good worlds, they save us all. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we seek you out as we live our busy lives, as we feel pressured and overwhelmed. We seek solace in your love. Please help us, God, to center on Jesus as we seek to understand what you would have us do to nourish our good world. And give us the strength and courage to then go out and do just that. Through you, God, working alongside others around the world who are feeding their good world, let our efforts compound to make truly global changes. As Jesus fed the masses with 5 loaves and 2 fish, work through us to feed millions of good wolves. Help those wolves to protect our community, both local and global, to feed the poor, to heal the sick, to free the oppressed, to heal our planet, to love our neighbors. We ask these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. We now enter into a time of silent prayer and musical meditation. could join me in praying this prayer in this hour. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Upon you and give you peace, now and forever. Amen.